Welcome to our webinar, Game-Changing Innovations for mAb, Recombinant Proteins and Biosimilar Development. I'm Miriam Monge, Director of Marketing for Integrated Solutions and Process Development Team Lead at Sartorius Stedim Biotech, and I'll be your host for today's webinar. So in our webinar today, we'll start with a rapid view of some of the key industry challenges for bioprocess development. I'll then come on to introduce our speakers, all specialists in their area, who will introduce you to some of Sartorius's latest technologies, software, and service innovations that enable you to rise to meet these bioprocess development challenges. So what are the key challenges faced by biopharmaceutical companies in process development today? Well, many of the challenges are related to drug safety, speed to clinic, time to market, and cost of goods. To address these challenges, companies must rapidly and cost-effectively develop well-characterized, robust, and compliant processes which deliver high titers to meet cost of goods objectives. Our aim at Sartorius is to develop process platforms that combine outstanding technologies, process control, and now we're adding the biology to single-use bioprocessing with our Selca expression system and bio-outsourced pre-qualified biosimilar assays. We'd like to give you an overview of some of these game-changing innovations in our webinar today. So our first speaker is Christoph Grimm. Christoph is a product manager for protein bioprocessing within our cell culture media team. Christoph, welcome.
Thank you, Miriam. I'm going to be presenting to you a short overview of a new approach for media optimization service, so-called Shoptimizer. Why does medium matter? It all starts with media. Without an appropriate growth medium, no biopharmaceutical process would exist. The proper medium allows for cell to grow and generate product. The medium represents also a large portion of the cost of a biopharmaceutical process. Cell culture media are complex entities that encompass large quantities of raw materials as well as a high level of technical expertise, driving up the cost per liter. So what are the advantages of an optimized medium formulation compared to the off-the-shelf product? Many people will choose to start with standard off-the-shelf product. It's easy to use for the cell culture processes. There is a wide variety of products available on the market. There are several important reasons to consider using an optimum media formulation instead still. The first is to tailor a medium formulation specifically for your own cells. Every cell line will respond differently to a standard product, and optimizing a medium formulation is the best way to ensure that you use a medium that works best for your application and requirements. Using a standard product also means you are bound to a single vendor with no access to proprietary formulation. With your own optimized medium, you have full access to the formulation with the ability to manufacture it with the vendor of your choice. So what are the resources that are required to develop an optimum medium? The resources required for an optimum medium formulation that drive up the ultimate cost per liter are time, personnel, equipment, and expertise. With the increasing use of multivariate approaches like design of experiment, principal components analysis, the use of high-throughput system becomes highly advantageous, reducing personnel requirements, time, and labor. Finally, expertise in media development is something that comes only with years of experience in the industry and cannot be bought with any amount of money. So you really have to drive your own expertise to be able to reach it. So that's where suppliers can help you. We did a case study that demonstrated the efficiency of this approach. There are several approaches to media optimization. Some methods include titration, reverse engineering of other media, and metabolomics. While some of these methods are effective, when implemented on their own, they are time-consuming, labor-intensive, and heavily resource-dependent. A modern DOE-based approach to media development for show-based processes is the Shoptimizer Media Builder. Shoptimizer consists of three distinct phases to get to the optimized media and feed and strategy. The package is designed to be integrated into our Amber 15 microbioreactor system for automation and ease of use. So finally, Shoptimizer combines a modern, high-throughput approach with traditional ideas to deliver an optimized medium in a short timeline with field-based support. It also offers full access to the formulation for ultimate flexibility in the future. Shoptimizer is a game changer. Thank you, Miriam.
Thank you, Christoph. So our next speaker is Mwai Gwibini from TAP Biosystems, part of Sartorius Stedim Biotech, and Mwai is going to speak to us about the AMBER-250 modular system.
Hello, everybody. My name is Mwai Gwibini. I'm the product manager for the AMBER-250 system, and I would like to introduce the system to everybody. This presentation will essentially cover two main things. We'll look at the AMBER-250 bioreactor and all its components, and we will then look at the technology within the system. So, to start with, what are the main components for the AMBER-250 modular system? The first component is the bioreactor, the single-use bioreactor vessel. This is essentially a single-use bioreactor integrated with all the sensors, which include the pH electrode and the DO spot, as well as all the filters and sampling ports and harvesting ports. In addition to that, the vessel is fully integrated to five reagent reservoirs, two of which are 125 mils lying on either side of the array, and the three of them in the middle are all 50 mil. Adding on to that, each reservoir is then integrated to syringe pumps, as you can see there, which makes a single-use vessel, which makes a single-use vessel come as bioreactor, reagent reservoirs, and syringe pumps, all as one unit. Now, if we look at the bioreactor in a lot more detail, there are two variants of the bioreactor. There's a microbial bioreactor, and there's a mammalian bioreactor. They are very similar, and we'll talk about the few differences between them. But to start off, we look at the microbial bioreactor. Each bioreactor has baffles, and each bioreactor will have a sponge tube, which is connected to three gases. All of these gases come in via mass flow controller as standard. The bioreactor also has DO sensors integrated into it, as well as five feed lines. So as we saw in the previous slide where we had five reagent reservoirs, all those lines get fed into the bioreactor. Following on that, each bioreactor will have its own single-use pH electrode. This is a standard pH electrode like would be available in standard benchtop bioreactors. For the microbial bioreactor, we have dual Rushton impellers, and then and this is quite unique to the AMBER-250 systems. Each bioreactor has its own dedicated off-gas analyzer, which calculates the oxygen uptake rate as well as the carbon dioxide uptake rate, carbon dioxide evaluation rate. Excuse me. And finally, each bioreactor has a septum cup. And this allows users to inject small amounts of additions into the bioreactor. If we then look at the mammalian version, as I said, they're very similar. The two key differences is in the gassing strategy. With the mammalian vessel, gases can be gassed either through the spudger or onto the headspace. All these gases come through mass flow sensor, again a standard. And the other key difference is that in the mammalian version, we have a pitch blade impeller instead of the Rushton impeller, which helps with the reduction of shear stress. Now, if we move on to the bar, the hardware of the system, so essentially a basic unit will have a controller, a monitor, which is a touch screen monitor, and a module. And a module is made up of two bioreactor stations. If we then look into this, into the hardware in a lot more detail, each module will have mass flow sensors, which will allow all the gases to be delivered into the bioreactors at a very high accuracy. Moving on that, you'll notice that in our bioreactors, we don't have a vertical exhaust gas condenser. It's actually horizontal and allowing for a very compact build of the bioreactor design. The monitor, as I mentioned, is a touch screen, and the software itself is easy to use and very intuitive software interface. And a single controller allows you to control up to 8 bioreactor systems, which enables you to be actually very flexible. Each bioreactor, as I mentioned, each controller has its own dedicated. Each bioreactor has its own dedicated off-gas analyzer, as I mentioned earlier on. And if we look at the aerial view of the bioreactor stations, what you notice is that you have positions of where the bioreactor and the reservoir slot in, and it's been designed to really set up this bioreactor very quickly. We call it a three-step process, and essentially it would take approximately a minute to set up a bioreactor. In addition to that, we have chilled reservoirs right at the end, at the back there, and this allows for liquids that are temperature sensitive to be maintained at temperatures of between 6 and 8 degrees. Again, this technology comes as standard with every bioreactor. So, as the name suggests, this is a modular system and it is expandable. So, a two-way system or a four bioreactor system can very easily be expanded into a 6 or 8-way system. And this can actually be done by the users themselves without the need for engineers to come into the labs. And essentially what this enables is that customers are able to increase their capability and increase their capacity with their needs.
Our next speaker is Chebe Vandermeer, Product Manager Purification Technologies, who's going to speak to us about SartorClear Dynamics. Welcome, Chebe.
Thank you, Miriam, for your kind introduction. I would like to welcome you to my part of this webinar, in which I would like to introduce our new harvesting technology, SartorClear Dynamics. One of the main messages of today's webinar is that thanks to the technological developments, new media and clones will arrive much faster to the commercial scale processes than before. This will not only bring us increased productivities, but it also means that we will have to deal with much higher biomass concentrations in the near future, and this is especially important for the harvest operation. Already today, we are facing average cell densities between 20 and 40 million cells per milliliter. This represents a solid content of 5 to 10% based on weight. This value is also known as the wet cell weight, which you probably know from microbial cultures. Also for animal cell cultures, this parameter is much more important for as an indicator for the harvest performance because it also considers the non-viable biomass, and this is a significant portion. At wet cell weight values above 5%, depth filter capacities are very low, and especially for volumes above 1,000 liter, centrifuges are often used as a primary recovery step in order to keep the cost low. However, since 2,000-liter single-use bioreactors became a standard, there is also an increased demand for new single-use harvesting solutions. Customers want to keep full flexibility, which is offered by single-use technologies. And with a stainless steel centrifuge, after a single-use bioreactor, this is not given anymore. Last but not least, I would like to mention the viability changes at the point of harvest. Changing cell viabilities are often the reason for suddenly reduced depth filter capacities. In order to avoid production issues, the process has to be designed to meet worst-case conditions, which often means extra filters. On our search for a new technology, we defined three main challenges for the harvest operations of the future. Apart from the high cell densities, customers are looking for single-use solutions, which are also economical on 2,000-liter scale, and further process robustness is looked for to simplify the process development. At Sartorius, we have been evaluating many technologies which potentially could deal with these challenges. Dynamic body feed filtration appeared to be our best option, and the product Sartoclear Dynamics is an optimized version for the harvest of animal cell cultures. Among the most eye-catching characteristics is the single-use capability up to 2,000-liter cell cultures. Further, body feed appear to be insensitive to viability changes, which makes this technology much shorter to develop. Filtration times are very short thanks to the high flow rate, which improves the planning flexibility of your facility. Last but not least, the harvest can be done in a single step, which further simplifies the development. What is body feed filtration? The filtration-based technology has been used since decades in other industries. Both plasma and beverage industry use it for changing fluid-solid separations, and these processes are actually very similar to the challenges that our industry is facing for the harvest. The technology is based on the addition of a porous filter aid such as diatomaceous earth. The DE and the biomass together will form a permeable filter cake on top of the filter. The more powder you add to the more permeable the cake will be. When you look at the picture below, you see a filter cake of cell culture biomass and DE of exactly 4 centimeters high. Believe it or not, but this cake is still permeable for fluids. If the starting DE concentration would have been lower, the cake would have been less permeable and it would have been blocked earlier, resulting in a lower cake. So this brings us to the essence of the technology. The goal is to find the lowest DE concentration that keeps the cake permeable enough to fill a complete filter housing. This sounds complex, but for mammalian cell cultures, the optimal DE concentration appears to be linear correlating to the wet cell weight. You only need to know the wet cell weight of your culture to calculate the requirement for large-scale processing. Later on, I will give you an example. On the next slide, I would like to show you how the process would look like. The first step is to transfer the powder, to transfer the culture to a mixed bag, and in the second step, the powder can be added. At this point, an additional optimization step such as pH precipitation or flocculation can be performed. More details about the precipitation and the flocculation options will be discussed during the pre-conference workshop in Vienna on the 11th of April. After the complete suspension of the DE, which takes about 5 to 10 minutes, the filtration can be started. The biomass together with the DE will form cakes in a parallel filtration system. Both the DE and all the biomass will retain in the filters, and the filtrate can be directly filtered over a 0.2 microfilter. The DE powder comes in 4 different bag sizes with a special new quick adapter. This adapter enables a fast transfer of the power to a mixing bag. This validated technology is dust-free so that operators can use it without wearing any protection. The powder inside the bag is Cellpure C300, which is an ultra-pure grade of DE and especially made for biopharmaceutical processes. In comparison to classical grades of DE, this grade is highly purified so that extractable levels are extremely low. All batches are tested and released for specified levels of impurities such as heavy metals and endotoxins. The terminal cake of biomass and DE is collected in filters which are optimized to host as much as possible biomass. The body feed technology allows for a very high flow rate so that filtration time will always be less than 2 hours. Further, the polyethylene filters inside are of a medical grade quality, and this avoids a time-consuming and costly WFI flushing as known for depth filters. The cassettes are ergonomically designed and will never weigh more than 50 kilograms. In many countries, this is the maximum weight that an operator is allowed to carry on a regular basis. Various holders are available. There is a pilot scale holder for 1 to 6 filters, but also various process scale systems with up to 3 layers for each 12 filters per layer are available, so that you can easily harvest more than 2,000 liter cell culture. Last but not least, I would like to provide you some application guidance for the body feed technology. I already mentioned that the technology gives very constant performances for different cell cultures. Based on many trials with cell lines from various customers, we can provide the following indicative requirements. So when you look at the example on the right, you see the very common characteristics of a modern cell culture. With a wet cell weight of 8%, you have 80 kilograms of biomass in 1,000 liter bioreactor. Based on a 25% ratio between biomass and the diatomaceous earth, you need only 20 kilograms of diatomaceous earth and 30 filters to rapidly harvest a 1,000 liter of cell culture with these characteristics. The filtration time would be around 1.5 hours. With that, we are coming to the summary. Sartoclear Dynamics is a new single-use harvesting technology that can easily handle 2,000 liter scale processes in an economical way. The capacities are constant for different mammalian cell lines and not impacted by viability changes, which makes the technology very attractive for biosimilar developers. Last but not least, Sartoclear Dynamics can handle cell densities of 50% wet cell weight, which makes the technology ready for the high cell density cultures of the future. If you are interested in learning details about this technology, I would like to invite you for the pre-conference workshop of the IBC in Vienna, which will be on the 11th of April this year. Hope to see you there.
Thank you very much, Tieba. We do indeed. I hope to see many of you at our workshop on the 11th of April. So I'm very pleased to introduce our next speaker, Mario Becker, who's Director of Marketing, PAT, and Automation. Welcome, Mario.
Yeah, hello also from my side. I would like to provide you an overview on opportunities for PAT and data-based bioprocess optimization. Let me start with a recap of the major challenges in biopharmaceutical manufacturing. So how to prove reproducibility of production, how to avoid faulty batches and improve safety of operation, how to ensure consistent and adequate product quality, and how to gain better control over the process and optimize the processes to stay competitive. We've been talking a lot about new groundbreaking technologies, but besides that, I would also like to draw the attention towards process data. Data containing causal information really helps to improve operations and make faster, more intelligent decisions. But what's the most efficient way to get the relevant data? I think it's two dimensions. It's the data aggregation, the data acquisition, but on the other side, it's also the generation of the data. And obviously, sensor technologies are kind of a key. And if we take a look at major trends driving more from lab towards online and inline sensor technologies, specifically in the single-use world, we are facing the issues of having single-use sensor technologies available in a fully integrated manner. From Sartorius, we are very much focusing on fully integrated plug-and-play monitoring and control loops based on advanced real-time analytics, but also based on scalable single-use sensor technologies which are fully incorporated into the various unit operations. Besides that, providing also a fully adapted and integrated SCADA system with integrated design of experiments and multivariate data analysis functionality. I would like to use this session to provide you some more details specifically on the data side. Just to give you an overview on one of the key changing sensor technologies, I would like to highlight the ability of measuring nutrients and metabolites fully automated online by using the BioPAT Trace technology for real-time glucose and lactate monitoring. So this technology is fully integrated into the local bioreactor control and provides you with automated feedback control loops for ensuring constant glucose levels, which finally help you to reduce the sampling to ensure 24/7 availability of glucose measurement, establishing feed controls overnight, over the weekends, finally ensuring way more process consistency. The second really innovative sensor technology is based on a capacitance technology called the BioPAT Biomass technology, which is inline viable cell density monitoring, which can be used, for example, to maintain a fixed biomass concentration during fed batch of perfusion-based cultivation. And you will see this available in rocking motion bioreactors as well as on stirred tank bioreactors by mid of this year. So applications are, for example, to automatically stop the feed and initiate harvest, also transfer at fixed bed cell concentrations rather than for fixed times. Another opportunity to increase consistency and reproducibility of the batches as such. However, sensor technologies need to be fully incorporated, and the challenge still is how to establish the control loops and how to apply them across the entire product life cycle. And there it's again all about data acquisition and the use of control recipes across scales. Starting, for example, with clone screening and media screening, in this case based on the EMBA 15 platform, challenges to set up the experiments in the most efficient and lean manner. Therefore, you will find a full integrated design of experiments platform based on the BioPAT model in the EMBA 15, generating high valuable data during your clone screening, media screening. Next step will be the process parameter optimization. In this example, using the EMBA 250 to identify the optimal process parameter conditions. Again, here you will find a fully integrated design of experiments software, which provides you predefined sets of experiments tailored to the EMBA 250 system, guiding you through the workflow. This data can be transferred to the central data acquisition system, so-called MFCS, where you have the data from EMBA 15 and EMBA 250 now available. Next step would be to apply your defined process control to your pilot scale. In this case, as an example, taking an STR 200 liter volume. So what you do here is you apply your process control, which you've developed in EMBA 250, and apply it here at a 200-liter scale. And the key challenge here is to identify the challenges and the patterns during this scale-up. And therefore, also this concept of having your data centrally stored in the MFCS allows you to compare your data sets from pilot scale and from early process development scale by using multivariate data analysis tools, which give you easy access to the key pattern information of your respective data. Afterwards, in terms of doing the robustness testing and the validation of your process, in this example using benchtop bioreactors at a 5-liter scale, this overall concept allows you to mimic your pilot scale in a bench scale, applying the same control recipes, and again using multivariate techniques to identify the key pattern and correlations of your data as such. Finally, after your validation, you can go ahead with your same control recipe strategies in commercial scale. In this case, taking a 2,000 liter steel tank reactor as an example. And you can imagine ensuring the scalability not only on the geometrical parameters, but also from a process control perspective, will allow you to already gain high valuable data across the product lifecycle, which allows you to finally implement your relevant process control model at commercial scale. And you will be able to implement multivariate data analysis in real time, where I would like to give you some more details on the following slides on that one. The multivariate data analysis, abbreviated with MVDA, is really kind of a key technology to simplify complex data sets. As we just saw during scale-up, comparing batches from process development and pilot scale, troubleshooting data from your scale-down models with final commercial scale. And the so-called BioPad Simca software, which is an offline data analysis tool, which is fully capable of comparing batches and scales and identify key trends and correlations. It's kind of a key element towards this strategy. On the other side, the so-called BioPad Simca online software, an online version of the Simca, allows you to monitor batches in real time for quality control, early fault detection, and isolation of issues. And the beauty of this, these tools are fully integrated into the data acquisition and process control platform, the MFCS, which we've been seeing on the previous slide. So the multivariate data analysis in real time is really the essential technology for future bioprocess analysis and control. And what we see here on the left side is status quo today. It's, well, how we do monitor our processes today based on univariate variables which evolve over the time. The beauty of the multivariate data analysis in real time is able to simplify this significantly, as you are able to merge all the relevant critical process parameters into one single data point at a time. So here on the right side, what we see in fed green is the evolution of the current batch. And each data point consists of all the critical process parameters, including the dependencies, including the weighting and the contribution of the various process parameters to the final product quality in an evolution over the time. And we see this in comparison to the golden batch in light green, which consists out of the historic data, which reflects the golden batch and the ideal state of the process. In red, we see the boundaries, which reflect the three times standard deviation. And you can imagine this visualization is very easy to understand for everyone taking care of real-time process control. What's the beauty behind that? It really allows faster troubleshooting, significantly reduces the risks of deviations, and ensures product and batch-to-batch consistency. You can imagine having this indication with your current ongoing batch in comparison to your golden state of the process. You can easily get an early indication of issues before they become deviations. What we do see here is an example where the batch moves out of the ideal range in this case, and what we can do with the software is to also drill down to get a root cause analysis on which of the parameters is contributing to these issues. Here in this case, we immediately see the ethanol content is the major contributor to the process problems that we do see here. And from here, we can further drive down and bring back the process to normal control. So just to summarize, the integrated platform of sensors and analytical systems from process development up to final commercial scale not only allows you to gather high-quality data, but also to turn it into information and process understanding, to demo your process understanding, and finally establish a process control which ensures batch-to-batch consistency and a high constant product quality. The integration of design of experiments and specifically multivariate data analysis tools in combination with a central data acquisition and supervisory control really ensures a fast track forward development up to clinic and an easy use of advanced tools, design of experiments and multivariate data analysis. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mario. So we come on to our last speaker, certainly last but not least, Daniel Galbraith, who's Chief Scientific Officer for BioOutsource, now part of Sartorius Stedim Biotech. So welcome, Daniel.
Thank you, Miriam. So I'm going to introduce you to you today the services that BioOutsource offers. BioOutsource was founded 9 years ago with the aim of providing a groundbreaking service to characterize new biologic molecules and to help move these products faster through drug development. BioOutsource is headquartered here in Scotland with 110 scientists here in Glasgow. We also have a facility in Korea near Seoul, and we also have our labs in Boston, which will be operational this year. BioOutsource has two divisions, the biosafety and bioanalytical. Biosafety provides critical safety data on the contamination of drugs with viruses or bacteria. And the bioanalytical division has rapidly expanded and provides a wide array of assays which are used to assess functional activities of biologic drugs. In this slide, I wanted to set the scene for the expectations for the overall characterization of a biologic drug. As we know, biologics start with recombinant DNA, which is transcribed into RNA, then into protein, which is modified and folded, and finally the functional drug is produced. During this last stage of processing, we introduce some heterogeneity to the product. This takes the form of different sugars which are attached to the proteins. The types of sugars which are attached are dependent on a number of factors, such as growth media or the stress levels of the cells or many other factors. But the result is that we have many different mixtures of proteins. The exact mixture of the proteins can be critical, as the different sugar molecules, these are known to affect some of the important functional activities of the drug. Now, in this next slide, we analyze proteins with a multitude of different methods to choose from. These cover normally physical and functional aspects of the drug, and here I've listed some of the more commonly used technologies that we use in BioOutsource today. Just to focus on the two technologies at the bottom of the table, binding and bioassays, these are the only methods which can really address the activity of the drug. At BioOutsource, we've spent the past 9 years developing and enhancing these key methods to help our clients understand their drug. So bioassays fall into four main types. By far the most popular are the cell-based assays, where we measure some kind of response by the cells to the drug. Today it's very rare really to use animals in these studies. Enzymatic or binding assays are used when we can't find a suitable cell-based assay, which mimics the function of the drug. These assays typically can be ELISA or SPR. The important aspects of bioassays is that they help us understand the potency of the drug in the clinic. These assays have become very important recently with the introduction of biosimilar molecules, as these assays are the only important feature of the compatibility studies which we need for the acceptance of the drug. Because of our large array of different methods, BioOutsource has become the leading provider for compatibility studies for biosimilars. Our aim has been to develop a panel of off-the-shelf assays for each biosimilar in advance of the client's needs. This, we feel, will reduce timelines and costs to our customers and reduce the burden on the quality control groups of the client internally. The bio-outsourced testing package varies with each biosimilar, but always contains the binding as well as the functional assays. Here we see the package for an anti-TNF-alpha molecule. To cover all aspects, we divide the assays into four types. On the left are the binding assays and the corresponding functional assays on the right. We also split the molecule into regions into two parts, the FAB and the FC region, which carry out very different functions. Now, having completed this profile, there should be sufficient coverage to complete for the comparability studies. As I've mentioned, there are a number of different biosimilars already under development, and illustrated here are the ones we commonly work with and their key associated methods. For each molecule, this adds up to at least 13 different methods for each drug. Now, new methods are continually being added, and also new biosimilar molecules become available following the end of their patent protection, and we add these to our portfolio. This is my last slide, and I wanted to share with you some of the information we shall expand on during the full presentation. Here we shall show the usefulness of bioassays in supporting and informing drug developers on the efficacy of their drugs. First of all, just to say, drugs such as Humira, for example, have many different possible interactions, particularly with the immune system. In the diagram on the top left, we can see four main mechanisms. ADCC uses natural killer cells to destroy the target. CDC activates the body's complement system, again, to kill the target cells. ADCP is a phagocytosis mechanism that eliminates the target cells. And lastly on the diagram, we have apoptosis, which is an induced reverse signaling pathway following binding of the drug to the cells. Now here, in this short presentation, I'm just going to focus on the ADCC activity, which is in the diagram on the top right. And below, we have two assays where we tested two versions of the same drug. The original, or the innovator drug, is in blue, and the biosimilar copy is in red. Now, ideally, if you were making a biosimilar, you would want to see the exact same profile of the biosimilar overlapping that of the innovator drug. On the graph on the left, we can see that there's some significant difference in the profile. The upper asymptote and slope for these drugs don't match. A conclusion would probably be that these two molecules have got different potency and different characterization, and therefore are non-comparable, and we would say they're probably very difficult to conclude they were biosimilar. Now, with the graph on the right, these drugs have the same profile with regards to the asymptote and slope, and the only difference really is a change in the magnitude, which is really corresponding to a change in the potency. And in this case, we can probably claim that these are biosimilar molecules, one being slightly less active than the other, but they have the same profile, so we would conclude these are more likely to be biosimilar. And this type of information allows manufacturers to really make some key decisions in moving forward with a drug, whether to take it forward, or if you've made any changes to the production process, how those changes impact on the drug. And as I've said, what we'll do in the longer presentation at the Congress, we'll use many multiple different methods and show how each method can help us understand how these drugs functionally are active and how any changes can affect this activity. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Daniel. So today we've been able to give you a glimpse of some of the innovative technologies and services that contribute to our process development platform at Sartorius, that seamlessly integrate upstream and downstream. We haven't been able to cover all aspects today. Notably, we haven't been able to focus on some of our innovations downstream, nor have we been able to present our process development team to you. We would like to invite you, of course, for a deeper dive into our process development capabilities to our workshop at the IBC Vienna on the 11th of April. Here we'll have the time to go in more on depth on technologies, notably on some of our latest downstream innovations with our Virusart MS, which is designed to deliver fast and economic media filtration, reducing the risk of viral contamination, which can cost companies millions of dollars. We'll have a case study from a client, Sinson, talking about their experience of working with the Sartorius Integrated Solutions team, rapidly scaling up their process from PD to commercial, and a more in-depth view on bioutsourcers' experience in biosimilar characterization through a case study. So we do hope that you'll join us. A link for sign-up will be sent on to all webinar participants. So with this, we're happy to end our presentation. Thank you so much for your attention, and we'd be happy to take any questions. Thank you.
Okay, so thank you very much, everybody. And we have had quite a few questions come through during this webinar. And one of the first questions I see is for you, Christoph. So question is, does the CHO optimizer work for any cell line?
So ShopTimizer is built for any CHO cell line. So really it's for Chinese hamster ovary cells. It's based on a long experience in media from the Lonza team and also on the expertise of the Sartorius application specialist. So ShopTimizer will also help you to better understand your cells and their needs and not only do a media optimization.
Okay, thank you very much, Christoph. Also on this subject, how long does it take to get to optimize media and feed strategy with the CHO optimizer?
As we clearly understand that time to market is one of the key factors for the protein therapeutics world, ShopTimizer, including the Amber 15 and the Modi system package, will effectively optimize your media and feed in less than 6 months, 25 weeks to be exact.
Okay, thank you. Question for Mario Becker and Dan Kopek. How is the data for MVVDA measured? Is it offline or online?
Yeah, the MVVDA model is based on historical data. Ideally, you would start with data from approximately 12 to 15 batches. And this data can also be gathered from PD to perform a retrospective analysis as a starting point.
Okay, thank you. And a question from Y on the Amber 250. So does data from the system show good scalability to large-scale benchtop bioreactors?
Yes, it does, primarily because the bioreactors are geometrically similar to the standard benchtop bioreactors or pilot plant bioreactors. So therefore, any data that is generated from experiments run on the AMBA 250 modular would replicate very well onto benchtop and scale plant bioreactors.
Okay. Can all the bioreactors be controlled individually? Is another question.
Sorry? Repeat that, please.
Can all the bioreactors be controlled individually?
Absolutely. So the controller is capable of controlling up to 8 bioreactors. Each of those bioreactors has complete independent control from degassing to temperature, agitation, and DO control. So yes, absolutely, it's independent control for each bioreactor.
Okay, thank you. Another question for Mario Becker and Dan Kopek. Can you please tell me more about the technology you used concerning the PAT? Is it Raman, NIR, etc.?
Sure. So we utilize a number of technologies for the real-time gathering data, which includes NIR, turbidity, the biomass, which is capacitance technology, as well as with the trace, the enzymatic biosensor, and we also offer the off-gas sensor. So all these are fully integrated into our bioreactors for plug-and-play use and generating control loops.
Okay, thank you. A question for Tieba. Can I use Sartorius Dynamics for other applications than mammalian cell cultures?
Thank you for the question, ma'am. That's a question that we get on a regular basis, and we have tested many different applications already, and some of them have been successful and others not. So successful applications were, for example, antibodies derived from plants or tobacco plants. So that was a very successful application. Also, vaccines worked on many cases. So what doesn't work, for example, is the harvest of E. coli lysates, or that is therefore you would need too much of the E, and then it's not a viable solution anymore.
Okay, thank you so much. And Another question then now for Mario and Dan. Do you have any further information on the mentioned MFCS SCADA system?
Yes, absolutely. So the MFCS is designed as a modular SCADA solution, and it can be extended in functionality along the drug product development lifecycle. So you can start with just data acquisition and charting up to a full server client installation, including alarming and S88 compliant recipe management and execution. In addition to that, we have integrated both DOE and NVDA into the MFCS SCADA system.
Okay, thank you. And a question for why, what are the main limitations of the AMBER 250 modular system to avoid an extension of more than 8 bioreactors? Why?
Yeah, hello, sorry. The system is designed to have up to 8 bioreactors. Anything bigger than that, we have the AMBER 250 HT system, which has up to 12 or 24 bioreactors. So the either choice of either AMBER 250 modular, 8 bioreactor system, anything larger, 12 or 24, then that's the AMBER 250 HT system, which is a fully automated system.
Okay. A question for Daniel Galbraith. So, Daniel, when is it most crucial to carry out analytical characterization in the development process?
Thanks, Mario. Thanks for the question. We would probably think it's best to do that at the scale-up stage when you're going from small-scale culture up to, you know, 5, 10, 50 litres and actually understand how your process changes are affecting the antibody you're trying to make. So it's probably during the scale-up you'll get most information, and that's the probably dangerous stage if you're worried about the characterization of the drug.
Thank you for that. Another question for Mario and Dan Kopic. So on the control system shown on the MFCS software talk, is it a feed forward or a feedback approach?
I'm sorry, could you repeat that question again?
Yeah, sure. So on the control system shown on the MFCS software, is it a feed forward or a feedback control system?
It is a feedback control system.
Okay, thank you very much for that. And another question for Daniel Galbraith. What are the benefits of linking structural and functional characterization?
It's a good question. The structural information tells us really what's changed with the product, and the functional really will tell us, obviously, what those changes influence in the characterization biologically of the molecule. So if we understand sort of what changes the bioprocessing has made, we can actually predict then what the functional changes are likely to be. So understanding the structure and then, you know, predicting the function helps us quite a lot when we're actually designing processes.
Okay, thank you. Indeed, many, many questions coming through here. So another one for you, Daniel. So what's the biggest challenge, in your opinion, in your experience of biosimilar development?
With the biosimilars, it's probably understanding the innovator molecule. So it's understanding, you know, your what you're aiming for. So for a drug like Humira or Herceptin, you know, it's getting enough data around about that innovator drug, and then being able to set your the range that you want to aim for, and then try and hit with your biosimilar copy. So the biggest challenge is really getting that data set around about what you're aiming for, I would say.
Mm-hmm. Okay, absolutely. Data is absolutely critical. So why? It appears that you've obviously convinced people that they need to buy the AMBER 250, because I've got people asking what's the price of the AMBER 250. I don't know if you want to share that information today.
No, I mean, one thing, I mean, what we'd want to do is obviously follow up on that question, so if they could contact us directly, we'd be very happy to discuss prices. But the one thing to mention is it's very, very competitively priced, so we would be happy to follow up that conversation offline.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much, Moi. Well, I think from what you can see, of course, there are tremendous opportunities, many, many innovations in development here at Sartorius Stedim Biotech as we rise to meet the challenges of mAb biosimilar development. We'll certainly be happy to discuss this further with you. If you'd like to contact us directly at Sartorius, if you go to the Integrated Solutions website, there is a page there where you can ask for a contact and we will follow up. And Integrated Solutions website then actually will send that to the relevant product managers in all the different areas that you have seen today. We'll also, of course, be present at the IBC Vienna conference, where we'll be giving a number of presentations, and we'll be happy to speak to you on our booth about many of these fantastic new technologies that you've had a glimpse of in our webinar today. So just like to thank all the speakers. Thank you very much for your time, and thank you for our very full attendance here at this webinar today, and look forward to seeing you all being well at the IBC in Vienna. Thank you very much. Bye-bye.